Welcome to the Idyllic Scribbler Show, a community podcast that goes alongside the Idyllic Scribblers blog, which is a youth-oriented, objective-driven community platform where you're free to express your thoughts. So for today's episode, as the title suggests, it's all about mental health, and we'll also be talking about Kota. And today's guest is Sana. So hi, Sana.
Hello, Imran. Thanks for inviting me on your show.
Yeah, thank you for being on my show. And since you've spent 2 to 3 years in Kota, you have a lot to talk about that place, right?
Yes, actually, I have a lot of trauma to talk about, to be exactly, because it's not an easy place to be in. And I don't think that it's going to get any easier in the future because the competition is not getting certainly low. It's just getting higher and higher. And I think students there are genuinely suffering and they're not getting enough help and they're not getting enough recognition for their diseases. I've seen so many students battling with mental health there, and I've even seen suicides happening like just next to my room or next to my building. So it's a really depressing place to be in, to like see dead people of your age and has that much potential. A simple example cannot just decide your whole life. Like you see human beings, young people, teens dying of, like they are full of potential, but they don't realize that because they've been pushed into a system where they've been told that JEE or NEET is all that matters to you, or this is life to you. There's nothing more than that.
So that is the overview of Kota, right? So, and before we go into Kota, deep into Kota, and we discuss more about Kota, I would like to give the people an overview about mental health in general, so that they know what mental health is and what mental illnesses are, so that they could understand the Kota scenario and the Indian scenario much better. So speaking about mental health in general, like according to me, mental health is like any health issue that is associated with changes in our thoughts, emotions, behaviors, and our relationships with others. So I feel it's a fundamental thing to have a good quality of life, and it makes our life more meaningful. It makes us more creative and an active citizen. So it's really important for us to stay mentally healthy. So what is your opinion on mental health?
That pretty much describes it. And I really hate that people are so generalizing it now, that I am so depressed or I am so anxious, I have anxiety. This is not how you define mental health. And first of all, we need to understand that mental health, what actually it is. Like people have these situations where they're like, I am so nervous. If you are nervous in a situation where you're supposed to be nervous, like an hour before an exam or an hour before some important job interview, you are supposed to be nervous because that's how you're made. You are a human being. You have emotion. You're going to be nervous before exams. That's not anxiety. That's not the anxiety you're talking about. That's not, you're not battling with mental health. Mental health is something absolutely different. I have anxiety myself for the past, I think it has been more than 16 or 17 months. And I am completely, the situations are like, I am completely okay, everything is going fine, I am with my family or my friends, and suddenly I feel this like a punch in my heart, and it feels like I am just gonna crumble down, I cannot get up, I feel my, like my body is getting numb, my heart starts racing really fast. So this is how I describe it, because it doesn't happen when you're supposed to be nervous, it happens when you're absolutely normal. And that's why there are so high suicide rates between students, because no one tells you that this is a situation that can happen with anyone. It's not, it's not like it cannot happen with you. It can happen with anyone. Anyone, everyone has their traumas. Everyone has their battles. Some people forgets them really easy, but some people couldn't. They have their baggage and they are not that strong enough to hold them all. So they suffer. And actually, parents are not having the talk with them that this can happen with you too. But I don't think parents are the fault in that, because I don't think they also know. They, I don't think everyone in this country is educated enough about mental health. Even parents are not educated enough about mental health, because Even the government is not raising any campaigns or any educational, they are not spreading any awareness. So parents are not at fault because they themselves don't know about it. How will they educate their children if they know that they think it's normal? Like you're supposed to suffer, but it is not normal. It can be really fatal and it can be really worse.
Yeah. So people are basically labeling it and painting it in the wrong way.
Yeah, they're taking it in the wrong way. Like many people tell, I've heard people talking about mental health that you're crazy. Like if someone is going to therapy or a psychiatrist, they think it's crazy. I don't think you're crazy. A therapist is, I think, a really good solution to whatever you're going through. It's not easy, but it is a step.
Yeah.
So we need to stop telling people that they're crazy.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Yeah. There's this social stigma attached with mental illnesses and, you know, people going for treatment in India, especially. So there's like stigma and awareness at the same time. These two are happening parallelly. Like technically they're interlinked, stigma and awareness. And it is really becoming difficult to tackle the burden of mental illness in India because of all the stigma associated with this.
Exactly. So and it is there. And it is not getting easier because now more young people are getting attached to mental health. And they have no idea what to do with it. Like they are struggling through depression, anxiety, panic attacks. And they have no idea how to survive because they have been told that going to a psychiatrist is a wrong thing. Going to a therapist is wrong. And now they are so scared that they won't even go to diagnose themselves. They have no idea what they're going through. They don't even know if it's depression or anxiety or panic attacks. Because they have been told that if you'll be diagnosed, you'll be tagged as crazy or like something, someone not normal. So I think we need to understand that it's completely normal to have breakdowns, have panic attacks, because you are a human being. If your body can get sick, your mind is a part of your body, I think.
Exactly, exactly. And actually, mind is the most important part of the body.
Exactly. So, and it can get sick and you need to take care of it. People need to be more aware about this.
Yeah. And some people also say we live in an age of anxiety. What would you comment on that? The term age of anxiety.
We live in an age of anxiety because there are so many things going on so many levels. Even the teens are suffering from a lot of things. This, when we clear our 10th exam or 11th exam, there's this pressure that what are you going to do with your career? And we are barely 14 or 15 years old, I think, when you pass 10th grade. And deciding what you're going to do for the rest of your life, that decision is really hard for a 15-year-old to make.
That's so a huge burden.
It's a huge burden, exactly. And when you reach an age of maturity, of 17 or 18, and you realize you have been doing it all wrong, and now you cannot turn back. You have already in quota. You are already in some place that you cannot turn back. So I think that creates an entire situation of, you know, mental issues. And parents doesn't ask themselves about, like, they need to talk to their children that what is going on? Do you actually want to do this? If you don't want to do this, you still have options. But I don't think they tell their kids that. They're like, they're just, you know, giving them more options that do this, do this. They're not actually asking them that, what do you want to do? Like, is that what you want to do? And when we talk, and it's not just about teens. Adults are facing it even at a larger scale because there is so much unemployment in our country. And due to coronavirus, I think it has become more fatal when it comes to unemployment. Most of the people in private sectors are unemployed right now. My mother is in government sector and her salary has been cut for the entire month. It is getting worse for people. Every single person in every single level, even if you are a teen, even if you are an adult who's doing a job, or even if you are a senior citizen, it's not easier for anyone.
Yeah. And this is actually a cycle. This is actually, I see this as a cycle. See, because unemployment, it affects your mental health. And again, these mental health conditions make it difficult for you to get employed again. So it is harming you in a lot of ways.
I don't think it's a cycle, and I think people need to help each other instead of just, you know, suffering on their own and not telling and not even talking about it to each other. I think there should be enough communication between people on their own that's what they're going through. I think that will create awareness, but I don't think you can blame people because it's really hard to talk about. I am talking about it now, but if I go like a year back, I just thinking about it made me cry, because situation you're in, you think that you're an utter disappointment and you feel guilty and sorry for every single thing in your life. You think it's your fault. You think there is something wrong with you. You think this is your entire life now and this is you. But I don't think that this is your entire life. I think it's just a small part in your life, which is also temporary. It's not permanent. It is temporary. If you look at it, there is so much more to you than just that small part. But people make it such a big issue that, oh, you are crazy. First, you need to accept that, okay, I have depression, I have anxiety. It's okay. It's a part of me. The more you will resist it, the stronger it will get.
Exactly. Yeah, that's correct. Yeah. And talking about diseases, there's a lot of diseases, you know, mental illness diseases, like there's depression, there's anxiety, there's bipolar disorders, and people associate symptoms with these. You know, people say just because you have low self-esteem, you have this happening, you have personality changes, you have anger, aggression, academic performance. There's so many things associated with so many diseases.
I don't think there are any actual, like, there are some exact symptoms to these. It depends.
Exactly. Yeah, that's what I'm going to talk about. See, unlike pathological diseases and other diseases, our minds are unique. Each of us have unique mindsets.
Exactly.
Our brain functions differently. And the way we get affected is also different, right?
Exactly.
So I feel everyone's experience of mental health is quite unique. And you can't generalize that. As you said, people are generalizing it. You can't generalize that.
Yes.
And, you know, symptoms are, I don't feel applicable in this case, because, yeah, there are symptoms. There are scientifically proven symptoms of particular diseases. But just because someone is not showing any symptoms, or maybe you're not observing someone's symptoms, does not mean he or she is not mentally affected. As you said, people have to look after each other, right?
Exactly. So it's not like you take everything as a symptom. As I said, being nervous in the situation you're supposed to be nervous, or being anxious and are supposed to be anxious, is absolutely okay. You cannot count them as symptoms and self-diagnose. First of all, self-diagnosis is a thing that I've seen a lot around. And then they call themselves, I am depressed, or I have anxieties, I have panic attacks.
Exactly.
They don't understand the gravity of those words. Some people are actually dying because of these words. They impact their lives with them. They use these words like, I see these words thrown around on internet everywhere. Depression, anxiety, panic attacks. It is not some words, some normal words, that random words that means nothing. It actually impacts the entire life. These words ruin people's life. Some even die from it.
Yeah.
So I don't think that's an okay thing to do. First of all, people need to understand that mental health is real. It is not some fake people trying to get attention. Nobody is trying to get attention.
Yeah.
And if they are trying to get attention, then I think there's nothing worse than that. That you are seeking attention on just the basis of like depression or anything, any mental issue. I don't think, like, if some person is genuinely asking you for help, he or she might not say the actual words, then please help me. But they will indirectly tell you that they are going through some things. So please talk to them, sit down with them. Don't ignore them. That's what I'm trying to say. Most of these
you
things...
need to be socially supported.
Exactly. These things, I think, get worse when you start ignoring people, like, you know, on the basis of like, it's okay, like she does it all the time. I've seen some people who ignored me, like, okay, it's her thing, it's her problem, she does it all the time. Stop ignoring people. They might be going through something real. If you actually care about that person, if you're actually consider them as your friends or any kind of, you know, like family or anything, you need to listen to them at least.
Yeah, exactly.
You need to create a socially acceptable environment.
Yeah, exactly. That is something that we are lacking a lot, especially in our country.
Exactly.
So since we're talking about our country, I would like to give you some facts and figures about the scenario of mental health in India.
Okay.
So according to the World Health Organization, almost 7.5% of our country suffers from some mental disorder. And that is just the diagnosed part. And you know, only 1% of the population actually diagnoses themselves for any mental health issues or any illnesses. Like 95% of the people, they just don't care. They just ignore it.
Exactly. We have 1.3 billion of population, and 7.5% of that is not a small number at all. And that is too diagnosed. We have no idea of the undiagnosed ones.
Exactly.
You cannot ignore 90 million people like that. You cannot ignore the entire fact that mental health exists. And that's what's happening in our country. We actually ignore that there is something like mental health. We ignore the entire fact. I have seen, you know, in Kota, when I was there for, I have been there for like more than 2 years, and I have seen students going through so many things. I know so many people that going through bipolar, and bipolar is, I think, worse than any mental health, mental issue you can even imagine.
Mm-hmm.
It's so horrible. And, you know, there are some consultants that those coaching provides you. I've been to one of those consultants and they are not helping you. Do you want to know what they actually tells you when you go and tell them that you're having problems? They actually tell you to isolate yourself and focus on your books.
That's worse.
They are, and you know the worst part, they are labeled as consultants. Specialized
counselors, right?
They call them consultants, counselor. Every single coaching has a word for them, and I've been to many of them. And you know, one lady was sitting in front of me, and I was actually telling her that I can't sleep for an entire week. You know, it's actually really a problem when you can't even sleep for an entire week. Like, I am awake till 6, and then I'm going to class, and when I'm even getting back, I'm not being able to sleep. So what I should do? And I don't have any friends, so I feel actually really alone. She advised me that, do you have time for friends? That's her exact sentence, to be honest. Do you really have time for friends? I don't think you do. She said that to me, and I couldn't hold myself. I just got out, and I think I really cried that day, because how can you say that to a human being? You're talking to a 16-year-old kid who cannot sleep for a week.
Has been going through stress a lot.
Exactly. She literally just told you that she cannot sleep for a week. And you advised her to be on books and forget about sharing, forget about talking about. That's why students are dying in Kota. That's the exact reason, because they're not getting any help. They're not getting any help.
And talking about help, actually there's only one doctor for every 1 lakh people in India. There's only one psychiatrist. So like, people, even if people want to get diagnosed, there's a lack of psychiatrists. So I think the government needs to address that situation as well.
Exactly. There are less psychiatrists, because I don't think psychiatrists are earning too much, and due to this reason they go to some other country, right? And that too, because Indian people have this stigma that going through a psychiatrist is wrong, apparently.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. So that's why I don't, I think it works like, you know, it is based on each other. It is like the pillars that holding the entire foundation. If like the one falls down, the foundation won't be strong enough. So I think that's how it works. Like it's so correlated. It's so correlated that now we're facing this problem that we don't even have enough psychiatrists. I haven't went to a therapist. Like I haven't went to a therapist for the past 12 months because I thought that I don't need it anymore. I stopped my medication and I stopped going to the therapist because according to me, I didn't need it anymore. I had the control inside me and I knew how to handle it. And I fortunately, I am so grateful to it that I have enough people around me that supports me through this and actually have been there for me for whatever I need. I have so many people around me and I'm actually really grateful for that. So I'm not saying that don't go to a therapist or don't do your medication. It's different for every single person. If therapy works for you, go to the therapy. Don't stop it. Go to therapy as long as you need it. Don't let anyone tell you different that you're crazy or you're whatever. Like why you're going to a therapist, you're a grown woman or a grown man. Don't let anyone tell you different. If medication works for you, take it. If therapy works for you, then go to therapy. Don't listen to anyone else. So I think people need to support more to each other. Like if that works for you, whatever works for you, you need to do it and we'll be there. We need to say this sentence more.
And mental health is rarely found or mentioned in any election manifesto of any political party. I've noticed that for quite a few years now. There's not a single leader who is addressing this situation.
That's the problem, see. There is, I have never seen even a single interview of any, you know, leader in position or leader in power talking about this or even addressing the situation. Forget talking about. Let's at least address it first, that it exists. We need to give it existence first. Everything else comes second. We are ignoring it completely. We are ignoring the existence of mental health. That is, I don't understand that. How is this happening? You have just told me 7.5%, which is 90 million. 90 million people, you're ignoring 90 million people. Like, I don't know how this number might be growing day by day.
It is growing. It is a lot more, actually. If you ask me, it's a lot more.
It is growing day by
day. Because this 90 million... Yeah, exactly, yeah. And the impact is far beyond imagination of this.
I have read some news the other day that many people have committed suicide because they were so depressed during the lockdown situation and they got panicked and they actually killed themselves. Yeah. When everyone has time, when the leaders can actually talk about the situation, everyone is talking about it. I have seen so many posts on internet that actually talking about mental health. I think that leaders should take actually an initiative. So many countries are even talking about mental health. I have seen some campaigns.
Yeah.
I think our country should also take some initiatives. I am in college right now and the teachers are shoving assignments down our throat. That too on the topics that we have no idea. How are we supposed to teach ourselves the topics? I don't understand the entire system, but we need to talk about it at least. So many people are going through mental health situation and they are getting worse during this lockdown because now they don't have their daily routines.
There's a lot of anxiety.
Exactly,
and fear
exactly. Like when I have my normal routine, my mind gets distracted. When I'm in a class, I'm not thinking about anything else. I'm thinking about the class. So when your normal routine gets broken down, these situations get more intense. You know, so like you're not thinking about anything else.
Yeah.
You're just thinking about anxiety. You're just thinking about like, what if this never ends? What if this takes like 6 months? What I'm going to do 6 months at home? It's starting to feel like, you know, like I'm trapped somewhere and I don't know what's going on. And I've seen so many people like bashing me on this, that you should be grateful that you have a home and have a family. I don't understand this, that why are we keep, you know, comparing problems? Like, oh, you should be grateful that you have a home. Some people don't even have homes. That's the issue too.
Yeah.
That's an issue too. But we need to stop comparing, you know, problems. We need to stop comparing that, okay, these
exactly,
problems are bigger, your problems are nothing. That's what it, that's what everything, you know, that becomes a problem in the first place. So we need to stop comparing pain, because pain is pain.
I don't know why people, exactly. I don't know why people prioritize problems. So they, this problem is bigger, this problem is smaller.
Exactly.
A problem is
exactly.
A problem,
a problem is a problem. A pain is pain. You cannot, you know, create a meter suddenly and you call me, okay, this is below five is not actually a problem. We'll deal with someone from below, above five. We need to stop comparing everyone on a scale. Everyone, you need to hear everyone's problem. We need to solve what is actually going on. And I think mental health is going to be one of the biggest problem in the future.
It is going to be bigger.
It's not getting easier for anyone, because mental health is one of the things people tell you that it gets easier, but trust me, it does not, because the baggage gets worse. You know, it does make you stronger if you've survived, luckily, but the baggage gets worse. The trauma starts to intensify itself, and then it will haunt you worse. I have, like, it has been a year since I've been out Kota, but still I have nightmares about it. I have feelings that I feel like that I'm still in that situation. I'm still crying at night. I don't know what to do. And I'm feeling like, I don't know how I'm going to pass this exam, how I'm going to do this. Because, you know, when you are in Kota, you are constantly reminded that you are born to do this exam and you have nothing else to do. There is not, the life has nothing for you right now. Everything to you is this fucking exam, and all you have to do is this exam. During my 2 years, I only met one teacher who told me that you have more potential than this exam. Even if you don't pass this, it is okay. Only one
it's
person,
not the end of things.
And I've met more than 30 faculties in Kota. And one, one, only one of them told me that it's okay. Even if you don't get through this, it's absolutely okay. It's not like your potential is destroyed just because you can't pass an exam.
Correct.
Exactly. Yeah. So it's like, and when you're in Kota, it is, you know, everyone is talking about, no one ever talks about something else other than exam. Everyone is like, question papers and everything. Everyone is discussing JEE and NEET. You get nothing else. When you're there, everything gets discussed in a manner that you feel stuck.
Yeah.
So that's...
And because of this, I feel you can't have a close bond of friendship.
Exactly, exactly. I felt so lonely. But I was, you know, surrounded by so many people. We had class of, I think, 200 students. Yet you feel like you're alone, like you're completely alone. You have no one. There is no one to hear what you have to say. And no one actually cares.
Yeah.
You know, I have students have become so cruel there. They have become so cold-hearted.
Yeah,
they don't
yeah.
even talk to each other now. The class filled with 200 people and nobody even cares about each other. They are just doing their own stuff. They see a competition, not a human being. Like, this other student can get a rank above me. That's how they made us to see each other. When I first stepped in Kota, the first advice the faculties keep giving us, that there are no friends. This is a competition. Everyone you have here is a competition to you. So don't count on someone. Like, someone is going to help you, or there will be friends. That's what they make us. That's what they tell us, that there are no friends. It becomes this, you know, this hatred relationship of complete hatred.
And also, for many students, I guess it is the first time they've stepped outside
exactly.
their homes.
I was 15 when I went to Kota. 15.
Okay,
and,
that's...
And yeah. most of the, you know, I have been told that more than 50% of students step in Kota between the age of 15 to 16 or 17. That's not in...
And they're taking a huge...
Exactly. And it's not a really mature age, according to me.
Yeah, exactly. And at that age, you're finding yourself alone in a city without any emotional or moral support.
Exactly. And you know, most of the students decide from themselves that they have to go to Kota. Like I decided myself that I have to go to Kota because I had no idea what it would be like. People just kept giving me suggestions and I followed. They created me that, you know, that Kota is everything. If you score good in 10th, then you have to go to Kota. That's what they tell us. That's what they keep pushing us about. So that's all you know. You don't know anything else than that. So that's...
Yeah. And also then there's administration and institutes that have namesake issues to bring down stress. As you said earlier, they have counselors and like consultants where you can go and talk to them, but I don't think they're useful.
They are
like
of no help. Students are getting so much bad advice from them. Hence, we know what is actually happening there. They actually advise students to stay away from each other, which I think is the worst advice you can give to any human being. Let's forget about any age, any human being.
Human being, exactly. And also about coaching centers, this happens everywhere, all over the country. But since we're talking about Kota, I think this is more prevalent over there. Coaching centers have, you know, this obsessive focus on toppers or the students who have like higher grades, and they have the strategy of segregating students into batches. And I feel that damages, you know, the rest of the students and they feel incapable and it adds up to other things.
You know, that is absolutely true. I still remember there are some top batches which have only less than 20 students. They have less than 20 students in each coaching center where then 1 lakh students are studying. They pick out 20 students and that too not of their own. They buy them by giving their parents some money or some, you know, some gifts. Apparently, they buy those students, those 20 students. They give the best faculties to them. They even give them a place to live where faculties are available 24/7. These 20 students are having
anytime, right?
They have proper help. They have faculties and consultants that give them actual mental health advice. That's it. These 20 in a puddle of 1 lakh students. That's how they segregate. They pick out 20 students and that's it. Rest of them, they don't even care about the rest of them. They just think, as you know, the rest of them are the mass number that these are from our coaching institutes. But you know, those they know that these 20s have been preparing since they were in 5th or 6th. You can't compete with them because they have all they have known since they were like 9 year old is JE. So you can't compare yourself to them. So these 20 are be like those top 10 or top 20 you see on the big hoardings or on news
newspaper.
Exactly. This creates an even worse situation because just these 20 students are getting you know, complete special treatment and the rest of them are like just, you know, left out of everything.
Exactly. And I guess other students also have to face embarrassment due to bad results,
Exactly.
and there's lot of this enormous pressure from
I didn't came
teachers.
out of my room for 2 weeks. I still remember that because my result was not good. I've given JEE twice and it was not as I was expecting. Still, I got into an okay college, but that's not the point, right? I've given a lot of time to Kota and to JEE, but I still didn't want the result I wanted. So what I do, like, do I kill myself? Because that's what they're suggesting. That's what they're hinting towards. And these thoughts have crossed my mind at that time, because it's really like a depressing, a depressing time, because you have been preparing for a thing for the past 2 years constantly, and all these 2 years, a 90 question multiple choice paper will decide that what actually you did in those 2 years. And no matter if you have worked really hard in those, last 2 years, you have no idea that what are those questions are going to be, because every single time, every single year, the questions are absolutely new.
And there's a lot of factors that
Exactly.
determine you
Doesn't
doing
matter
well
if
in
you have
an.
solved 20 books, it doesn't matter because the questions are not going to be from those books. Yeah,
Yeah,
so
correct.
I think this creates even a worse situation for students. Like, most of them are panicked and they can't even lift their pen or pencil up. They are that much panicked. Like, they know the answer, but still
Correct, yeah.
they go in this, like, a panic, entire panic situation. They go absolutely numb because they see a new question on the screen. Yeah,
Yeah.
they have been taught to solve different questions, and what if a completely different questions arises in front of you? What are you going to do? And
Yeah, that's
then
correct.
there
And
is a completely different issue of reservation.
yeah, that's a whole
Exactly, that's
different
a whole
story.
different story. So I think education system is mostly responsible for mental health in students.
Yeah, exactly. That's correct.
That's
That's correct. Like, people also need to accept the fact that not everyone can get a seat in JEE
exactly.
or NEET,
You,
because
it's not compulsory for you to be in JEE. 10 lakh students, more than 10 lakh students sit every year in an exam in which only 10,000 get selected. The possibility less than 1%.
It's
Less
less
than
than
one percent.
1%.
So you have to prepare. The thing is, they have been preparing us for, the success that, okay, when you'll pass, what college you'll choose. They talk to us like that, but nobody prepares us for the failure. What if you don't make it?
Correct, exactly. Just because you don't get in JEE or NEET doesn't mean that you're a
Yes, you're a
poor
failure.
loser.
You cannot do anything. It doesn't mean that. I didn't get good score in JEE, but I think I'm doing good in college. That doesn't mean that it's 2 years.
Exactly. This applies to majority of the students in India. Like, almost all students
Almost
even
all
cover under
students,
this.
almost all students. Everyone, even the topper is going through, I think, mental health issues. Issues because the amount of pressure on him is, I think, so much more than us. They've been expecting.
Correct. And they're also lost in some ways. They're lost because they don't know what to do next. And there's so many issues. You can discuss about issues for days. There's so many things,
Exactly.
so
In
many
the end, I
factors.
think I would like to summarize it as you need to stop, fighting this thing. You need to accept as soon as possible. You need to tell someone about it who actually
Exactly.
understand. You need to tell someone about this thing, someone you can count on. And you actually should go to a psychiatrist to diagnose it.
Correct. Yeah, people should like they should take the initiative. They should not worry about the stigma
Exactly.
associated, and also the external factor should be supportive. Like there's so many external factors. It could be your parents. It could be the system in general. There's so many things, but this is a two-way
Exactly,
thing.
I think.
So, for example, yeah, because see this in during this crisis, coronavirus crisis. The celebrities and politicians coming out giving awareness about coronavirus, telling us to stay inside. But none of them are addressing this mental health situation. They're not addressing the fact that people are going to face this problem. There's so many problems in the urban landscape. There's particular problems. Then in the rural landscape, there's a whole different problems associated with mental health. So I feel the system needs to do
I
its
think
part as well.
yes, they need to
So they need to
they
take
need
the
to
initiative.
get the wider spectrum of the entire situation, I think. They need to talk more about the
Yeah.
situation. They need to talk about more about the issues rather than just staying inside. We get it. We get it. We need to stay inside. We need to wash our hands. Stop telling us to do the same thing over and over again and start addressing the issues that are not
Yeah,
being
correct.
talked about. Start addressing other issues.
Exactly, yeah,
They have just
exactly.
been telling us to stay inside and wash our hands. Okay, done that. What's next? There are so many
Correct, yeah.
issues
Everyone
that people have been
knows
going
that.
through all around the country, and I don't think any political leader or any influential person have talked about this.
Correct, yeah. They
They
haven't, they
haven't, and
haven't.
they need to step up
So,
at some point.
correct. And not just this coronavirus crisis, but even for the longer run, we need to prepare ourselves because this issue is not slowing down, right? People are getting mental illnesses every single day. Someone realize or they get diagnosed with mental illnesses, and there are so many undiagnosed people as well. So this is just on the rise,
Exactly. And
and this is going to rise for sure. Going to
need
rise.
to go through that. There's nothing wrong with going to a psychiatrist or going to therapy or taking medications. There's nothing wrong with any of that. There's
Yeah.
nothing wrong with any of that. It's you should
Correct.
do what you feel is right. It's your body, it's your mind. Don't think about any other human being right now that they'll judge you or they'll think you're crazy. Forget about them. Think about yourself. I think the priority should be in this, should be you. Priority yourself to you is
Correct.
you.
Yeah.
Everyone else comes next. You should think about yourself first. You
Exactly.
need to, you deserve to
Yeah.
be better. Nobody deserves to suffer like this. This is, I think, a really slow torture. I don't think anyone deserves to suffer like this. So,
Correct. And the worst part is like no one knows about
exactly.
this happening to
You
you,
don't
right?
know. You
Only you
don't
know
know
about it.
how it is going to happen to you. When is it going to happen to you? And like, what exactly are
Correct.
the
Yeah.
symptoms? You know nothing. You're going in blind. So you think that there is something going on. You need to see a psychiatrist. You absolutely should go
Correct,
see a
yeah.
psychiatrist and go for therapy if needed. If you need, I think you need medication. I have seen so many people that medication is actually really effective, and it's really effective.
Yeah, it does help,
But
but it depends.
some people associate it with
Yeah, it
that,
depends on people.
like they're actually taking drugs. I don't think that they are different. They are prescribed by a doctor. When I think
Correct, yeah.
I even think that doctor prescribed Xanax for anxiety issues, and people associate it with, like, you might
Yeah.
have a drug problem. I don't think you'll ever have a drug problem. The doses are completely different, and it's not pure Xanax, and it's prescribed
Yeah.
by a doctor. So stop Googling.
Yeah.
Actually,
Yeah.
stop telling anyone that you're gonna be a drug
Exactly, that
problem.
is a problem.
Nobody's gonna have a drug problem. The doctor is absolutely gonna get take
Yeah,
care of you
correct,
that, and
exactly.
those drugs are not available without prescription. Yeah,
Exactly correct. Yeah, you can only
exactly.
legally buy them
So
with
you need to
prescriptions.
stop thinking about all of that. That what if I'm what people are keep telling me that I'm a drug addict, or you're not a drug addict and you're not gonna be. these are legally prescribed drugs.
Yeah.
These are legally prescribed medication that a actually doctor who went through medical school gave you. So you need to trust
Yeah,
your
correct.
Doctor, I think. Rather than some random
Yeah.
people who just Google some random things and then they come talk to you.
Yeah, that just leads to
Exactly.
things getting more worse. Misinformation is really bad.
Yeah, so.
So that's there. Yeah, and if you had to give some quick tips or like to stay mentally healthy, or, you know, I know it's not really the full complete picture, but still I feel there are few remedies that can help you, you know, stay
there
mentally
are
fit.
There are a few
So,
ways, and every way is different for according to a person. Like meditation works for some.
Correct.
Meditation doesn't work on me. I've tried it so many times, but it doesn't work with me. But it do works for so many people.
Yeah.
If it works for you, do it. It rarely takes about 10 to 15 minutes, I think. And find a thing.
Yeah,
like
correct.
In this time, you have so much time on your hands. Find something that you always wanted to do, but you couldn't because of your schedule or whatever. Like I wanted to read so many books that I've been, you know, saving them for later. And now I finally have time to read all those books. Some people like painting, some people like have talents.
Yeah.
So they need to get them out. Yeah,
Yeah, you can
you
work
need to work.
them.
That's going to take
Exactly,
your
yeah.
mind off those things, and you'll feel more positive and you'll feel more energized during the day. Yeah, do
Yes,
whatever
exactly,
you
yeah.
like to do whatever you want to do. You always like watch movies, watch if you want to sleep however you want, how long as
Exactly,
you
yeah.
want. There is no
Very
limitations
important.
to them now.
Yeah,
So
correct.
I think you should
Correct, correct.
find a thing for your own self, that this is my time, this is me time, and I'm going to do all things that I've been saving or I couldn't do during all those things, all those crazy schedules that have been keeping me up, all those exams. But now you have the time, so much time on your hands, and I think the clock has stopped ticking now, because everything has stopped.
Correct,
Everything
yeah,
has
exactly,
stopped in this
yeah.
world. No, nothing is moving. So you're not losing anything. So you need to find something for yourself.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And if I had to give a tip, like this is what I give to everyone. I feel people should develop more bond with nature.
That is
Spend
the
more time with animals and
most
plants.
effective thing I've ever experienced in my life. I myself have a small garden, and it feels
Exactly.
so nurturing to see, you know,
Yeah.
plants grow, and it feels actually good to see, you know, plants and flowers around you.
Exactly, yeah.
That's
Correct. So
exactly.
nature and plants are like all different. I can talk about them for days, so we'll save that
Yeah.
for another episode.
So thank you for having me.
So that's there. So yeah, so in short, if I had to summarize, just educate yourself on mental health, be empathetic to people, and don't discriminate or have a social stigma against mental illness. So thank you so much for coming to my show. Thank you so much for sharing your experiences about
Thank
Kota
you for
and
having me.
everything. So it was really helpful. I learned a lot, actually. I learned a lot about Kota because I've never been to Kota. So I only heard about it. So getting a personal insight was great. And I hope people also relate to this, because I know a lot of people who've been to Kota and they might share similar things. So, and I hope people get influenced by this in some way. So
okay.
Thank you so much. So, and thank you, everyone. I'll link everything downstairs, all the social media links. So keep following our podcast, keep following our blog. So, and we'll be back next
okay.
week with another episode.
Thank
So
you for
thank
having
you so
me.
much, everyone. Have a great day.